In 1948, Howard Hawks directed A Song Is Born, a late-period screwball comedy centred on an out-of-touch music professor's introduction to jazz music. The film, itself a near scene-by-scene remake of Hawks' 1941 film Ball of Fire, gathered together a group of well-known jazz musicians known primarily for their music popular a decade earlier. The film centres on Hobart Frisbee, a naive music professor played by Danny Kaye, contracted to write an encyclopedia of music for the privately funded Totten Institute. Seven older professors, each an expert in a particular field of musical history, assisted in the production of the encyclopedia, and this group of scholars works diligently without much contact with the outside world. Early in the film, however, two black window washers played by Book and Bubbles, an African-American comedy team, enter the institute in hopes that the professor could help them with a radio quiz concerning music. One of the window washers sits at the piano and begins to play along with the professors, ad-libbing a boogie-woogie tune as an accompaniment to a classical piece by Bach. Stunned by the performance, Frisbee realises that his section on folk music remains incomplete without the inclusion of this jazz vernacular.
Gentlemen, I'm an idiot. An absolute idiot. And I'm terribly grateful to both of you for making me aware of it. Do you realise that since we've been cooped up here, music has changed, and changed considerably? I've been completely unaware of this situation. However, I intend to rectify it immediately.
And he scurries off into the variety of nightclubs to recruit an array of jazz musicians to elucidate this music, henceforth unknown to the professor. Frisbee eventually compels a number of famed jazz musicians, including Louis Armstrong, Tommy Dorsey, Louis Belson, Mel Powell, Lyle Hampton, and others, to sketch a general history of jazz music. Although unfamiliar to Frisbee by the late 1940s, this group of musicians represented some of the most famous jazz performers of the last 15 years. In one scene, the jazz musicians teach Frisbee the convoluted interconnections of jazz styles. A chalkboard behind Frisbee lists a number of subcategories such as Dixieland and swing, and then the group performs a short improvised jazz piece to illustrate their pedagogical point. Despite the history lesson, the film disregards the larger shift in values that provide the context for the creation of jazz, as well as the resultant controversy stemming from the music's popularity. The director even plays the underworld connections to jazz for comedy, and Honey Swanson, the gangster mole played by Virginia Mayo, appears more for the romantic subplot than an indicator of the immoral elements in jazz music. In addition, the elderly housekeeper of the musicologist disapproves of Swanson's temporary tenure at the Institute, but has no real qualms with the music performed by the professors, aside from complaints of volume. Armstrong and Dorsey serve as elder statesmen, eager to educate Frisbee on the finer points of jazz, but though only a few years removed from its prime, the music seems simply another valid step in musical evolution. Illustrating this point, Hawks cast Benny Goodman, the primary articulation of popular jazz in the 1930s, in the role of Professor Magenbruch, a classical clarinet virtuoso inherently able to adapt his classical training to the syncopated rhythms of jazz. The King of Swing thus plays the square, and the film distances jazz absolutely from its historical context. Overall, the film avoided any comment on the issue of race, the defining element in the evolution and subsequent controversy of jazz during this period. A casual, integrated spirit frames the music numbers in the film, and a firm connection to Africa organises the history segments. But aside from Armstrong, the most prominent black characters in the film remain the two window washers, performing a comedic role, speaking jive and expressing an innate ability to play music. By removing the issue of race from the jazz narrative, the film deftly avoids a discussion of the larger controversies that accompanied jazz throughout the 1920s and 1930s. It didn't seem to matter that jazz itself was going through a transformation into what is now called modern jazz, and that Armstrong was one of the major critics of this new form of jazz, now known as bebop. In 1948, Howard Hawks could produce a film centred on jazz and expect the audience to accept the music as an uncontroversial aspect of American musical culture. Produced a decade after the peak of the swing era, in other words, A Song Is Born postulated jazz as a perfectly acceptable subject for both a film as well as an academic pursuit. Jazz owed much of its place in American culture to cooperation between white and black musicians in informal jam sessions and meetings. Since at least the mid-1930s, integration among musicians also took place on stage, and this prompted many writers and musicians to celebrate jazz as a force to eliminate legal and social discrimination in America. However, writers and musicians rarely had the same praise for the wider industry. Almost all of the businesses were owned and managed by white people, and efforts to end de facto segregation in jazz met with nearly as much concerted resistance as legal segregation. Black musicians were rarely featured in the American press before World War II, but they began to have an unavoidable presence after the first prominent jazz band was integrated in 1936. However, both the mainstream and musical press remained disinclined to discuss racial discrimination in the industry until 1939, when several of the nation's most famous white bands hired black musicians. Critic and record executive John Hammond recalled that magazines such as Downbeat, that then supported integration, avoided the issue in the mid-1930s. But even at Downbeat, I was blue-penciled in areas important to me. I could write about Negro musicians, but not as people who could not get a break because of their race. Nor could I write about the many malpractices I'd discovered in the band business while working for Mills. In 1939, Downbeat covered several stories about segregation and its negative impact on the industry and on American society, including an article that highlighted the relationship between the music industry and its fight for democracy, with the questioning headline, "Democracy?" The article was about the Daughters of the American Revolution's DAR exclusion of singer Marian Anderson from their constitutional hall because she was black, and it concluded, "What was it we remembered from our history books about the American Revolution, from which the DAR took its name? Something about a war that was fought to make Americans free and equal. The ladies of the DAR had better check up and make sure." Another article claimed that racial discrimination raised its fat, ugly head when the license for a bar was revoked until the management fired the resident black band and hired white replacements. Perhaps the most incisive of the articles featured in Downbeat in 1939 was the front page headline, "Should Negro Musicians Play in White Bands?" The article reported the response of several white musicians. "No, definitely no," said many leaders and sidemen. "But why?" asked Downbeat reporters. "It's professional suicide," said one. "But don't quote me. It's not fair for Negroes to replace white musicians when there is so much unemployment. The union should forbid it," said another. "It will break down race lines," said a third. "But in music and art, we thought there should be no race lines," imposed Downbeat's reporter. A month later, Downbeat printed a reply by a black musician who vociferously attacked the racism of white musicians, especially as it was generally conceded that the Negro musician has been of tremendous assistance to his white brother in helping them create this latest craze, swing. As a supporter of integration within the industry, Downbeat allowed the black musicians working in early integrated bands to voice their complaints. One such musician was singer Billie Holiday, who toured with Artie Shaw in 1939. According to Holiday, the treatment she received from the management made her turn away from singing with dance bands for the rest of her career. Holiday had to stay backstage when she was not singing, and since Shaw gave in to pressures from theatre managers, she was able to sing only two tunes every night. In addition to the common practice of making black musicians enter through the back door and ride on the freight elevators, Holiday was often not even allowed backstage when she was not performing, but was forced to return to her room. Spending most of her time reading while the band played their sets, Holiday was at least getting her two songs aired on a national radio broadcast, which helped establish her national reputation. When Shaw finally had to stop her from singing on the radio, she quit the band. Many writers challenged the practice of segregation in the industry, but they could also reinforce the assumptions upon which those practices were based. One of the most prevalent of these was that the American public did not want and would violently reject integrated bands. This assumption formed a basis for articles such as those found on the front pages of Downbeat in August of 1939 with the headline, "Goodman adds noted Negro pianist." The article claimed that Benny Goodman dared to do what no other leader had done before in his decision to add Fletcher Henderson to his regular orchestra, and it later applauded Goodman's bravado by reporting, "Mixed bands have never been successful with the American public, but Benny is paying no heed to that accepted fact." This accepted fact appears to be little more than presumption. The article later notes Goodman had already toured for several years with his trio and quartet with Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton, and they were eminently successful, and that even in the South, Benny experienced no trouble with dancers. Only a month after adding Henderson, Downbeat reported that Goodman plans to add more Negroes to band. Once again, in seeming defiance of the accepted fact that mixed bands were not popular, Goodman was not a bit surprised with the success he had had in using a Negro pianist regularly with his band. Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton credited John Hammond for helping Goodman overcome the industry's disapproval in his decision to hire black musicians. Hammond's drive for racially integrated bands was matched by his power within the industry, and he enjoyed wealth, successful writing, and an executive position at Columbia Records. First, through his position at Columbia in 1935, Hammond arranged for Wilson to be bandleader on recordings with several top white musicians, including Benny Goodman, Gene Krupa, and Harry James. A year later, Hammond convinced Goodman to take Teddy Wilson on tour with him. Wilson was only allowed to play solos during intermission and as part of the Benny Goodman Trio, but this small group became famous for their live performances and records. Hammond guaranteed some powerful business connections and public support for Goodman, while according to Wilson, everyone else was telling him, "You're a bright young man, you're a very talented clarinet player, and you're going to blot your career at its very beginning. You're only in your 20s and you'll never be successful if you hire a Negro player." Ignoring the beliefs and attitudes of these show business people, Goodman decided to take the gamble, and it turned out to be a great success for him. And when he hired another Negro, Lionel Hampton, a year later, there was no doubt as to whether it would work. Despite their success, Lionel Hampton and Teddy Wilson both recall the difficulties they had faced when touring with Goodman in the mid-1930s, but they thought such difficulties were primarily the result of racist authorities and segregation rather than rejection from the audience. Hampton remembered that Downbeat carried the headline, "Predicted race riot fades as crowds applauds Goodman's quartet." In fact, we were so popular at the Paramount that we had kids screaming and dancing in the aisles. Clearly, it was the police and other civil authorities and not the audience that expected problems because of the integrated band. Generally, Wilson and Hampton faced the discrimination and segregation endured by black bands, but without the support that this black musical community could provide. While their white bandmates were able to stay in hotels and eat in restaurants, Wilson and Hampton had to head straight away to the Negro ghetto in the town to eat and sleep. Wilson and Hampton were also repeatedly mistaken for Goodman's valet or the band's water boy, but they had no choice but to accept the situation and play their music. Even white musicians like Goodman faced problems because of their use of integrated bands. Many Americans resisted integration, and some wrote to Goodman and to the managers of the theatres in which he played to protest the use of black musicians, and this anger was perhaps enhanced by success of the band. On one famous occasion, Goodman became so angry that he hit one of the theatre workers on the head with his clarinet when the men told him that he should get those niggers off his show. Such treatment in the late 1930s was common in an industry that remained almost entirely segregated. As John Hammond recalled, indignation at racial discrimination in the music industry helped in creating the first major venue for jazz with an integrated audience, the Cafe Society in New York City. Owner Barney Josephson, who was a businessman with little direct knowledge of the jazz industry, met with Hammond in 1938 to discuss the possibilities of opening a club in Greenwich Village. Jazz had been popular for over 20 years, but until Josephson's project, segregated audiences were stranded across the city. Hammond recalled their motivations in starting the club. "Josephson wanted what I had always wanted, an integrated nightclub with mixed entertainment and mixed audiences. It would be a place where I could put new jazz talent, a place where blacks and whites could hear the best music in the city. When Cafe Society opened, it became one of the premier jazz venues in New York City and remained so for over a decade, becoming a high-profile example of a successful integrated club. Some of the most famous jazz musicians secured or increased their fame with residency at Cafe Society, including Billie Holiday, Hazel Scott and Lena Horne. Despite this breakdown of barriers in the American North, it should always be kept in mind that segregation remained strict in the states of the South, and the state of Missouri introduced full segregation of education in 1945, just in time for black soldiers returning from World War II. So in some places, barriers to integration were being raised. In 1950, jazz bebop legend Charlie Parker had to pass off his white trumpet player, Red Rodney, as an albino Negro while on tour in the South.
Man, you know where they'll put us up. Some goddamn funky rat hole. Except you, Red. You probably find yourself a good hotel in every town we play in. I don't think so. Red, you're gonna be right down in the funk with us. Bird done covered it all right.
Oh, yeah.
During the bebop revolution of the 1940s, the white editors of Metronome magazine, Leonard Feather and Barry Ulanoff, coined the term Crow Jim to denote the increasing currency of authentic blackness that sometimes resulted in reverse discrimination. As Nicholas Evans puts it, jazz always involves race, nationalism and related concerns because it heightens the audibility, palpability and even visibility of the cultural sameness and differences of whiteness and blackness. One of the earliest examples of exposing Crow Jim was by Leonard Feather in one of his famous blindfold tests for the pages of Downbeat magazine. Throughout his distinguished career, Roy Eldridge had repeatedly expressed his firm belief that white and black jazz musicians had distinctively different styles and that he could easily distinguish between them. When Feather took him at his word and administered the test, the trumpeter, nicknamed Little Jazz by his peers, was either non-committal or wrong much more than he was right. Listening to Billy Taylor's recording of Ironically All Ears, the 7th of 10 selections, Eldridge's irritation mounted. I liked the pianist, couldn't tell who was coloured and who was white. They could all be Eskimos for all I know, he admitted, and had to concede defeat in the end. What happens though when whiteness ventures into enclave of jazz? In this arena, whiteness is not only challenged but sometimes even becomes a liability as it loses the privileges that are accorded to it customarily and tactically in most other areas of society, as we saw with Red Rodney have to pass himself off as an albino Negro. The case of Art Pepper is another example that points to a complex relationship between black and white, sound and image, music and spectacle, and is an interesting subject matter to illustrate the effect segregation had on jazz musicians who were white. Art Pepper was born on September 1, 1925 in Gardenia, California, to abusive alcoholic parents of German-Italian descent. Temperamentally alone earlier on, Little Art exhibited extraordinary musical talent and started taking clarinet lessons at age 9. Switching to alto saxophone at 15, Pepper began to frequent the bustling jazz scene thriving on Los Angeles' Central Avenue, where he was more often than not the only white musician on the bandstand, honing his chops alongside the likes of Charlie Mingus and Dexter Gordon. Despite his best efforts to fail the physical examination, Art Pepper was drafted into the army and called for basic training at Fort MacArthur, California. He was devastated. World War II had abruptly cut short what had looked like the beginning of a promising jazz career. The alto saxophonist had just gotten his first big break the year before when Lee Young, Lester's brother, recommended him to Benny Carter. To be hired by Carter, considered by many to be the top altoist in jazz at the time, would have been a major accomplishment for any jazz artist. But it was particularly significant for a 17-year-old white musician who played the same instrument as Carter. Unfortunately, Pepper's apprenticeship did not last long. Carter's orchestra was about to embark on a tour of the South and Pepper was given his walking papers. Benny told me it would be too dangerous for the blacks and the whites, both for me to go along. I couldn't understand why I had to leave the band and I didn't know what I was going to do. he later remembered. Thanks to Carter's connections in the business, however, Pepper landed a gig with Stan Kenton's all-white big band until the draft notice came. After basic training, Pepper was transferred to Camp Butner in South Carolina to be trained as a combat engineer and shipped off to the European front. While in South Carolina, he learned that his former employer, Benny Carter, would perform with his orchestra in nearby Durham, North Carolina. Arriving at the box office, Pepper was astounded to find the word Lodge on his admission ticket. Perplexed, young Art took his seat in the balcony, only to discover that his neighbours were all white, whereas the dance floor below was all black. Fortified by a few drinks, he decided to sneak downstairs to be closer to the music and his former bandmates, and in the process, unwittingly transformed his whiteness into a confrontational spectacle. I walked real fast, and as I approached the stand, I could feel the people staring at me, and then they started moving, and all of a sudden, they just closed me in. All of a sudden, there was a circle of black people around me, and they were saying, "What are you doing down here? What are you doing down here, white boy?" I said, "I used to play with this band. I want to say hello." They said, "You get out of here." And they all started yelling. One guy screamed, "You kill my grandparents, you son of a bitch, you white bastard. You beat my grandparents to death, you son of a bitch." I said, "I didn't kill anybody. I didn't do anything." But they kept raving, so I got mad. I shouted, "I don't want to hear any of your fucking shit. I didn't do anything to you." I was raging. I used to play with this band. I think I hollered Benny, and he jumped off the stand and ran down there. The ushers were saying, "You got to get out of here. Someone's going to kill you." Benny comes up to me and says, "Oh man," I said, "what is this? What kind of shit is this? I just wanted to say hello." He said, "This is what I was talking about before. I thought you knew about these things." I was crying by this time. They despised me. They wanted to kill me. Benny said, "There's nothing I can do, man. Come around after. We'll see you outside around by the bus." The ushers escorted me out. The spatial symbolism of Pepper's initiation into whiteness is telling. The up-and-coming jazz musician finds himself distanced from the art form he so passionately embraces. White privilege accords him what many of the day would consider the best seat in the house, both literally and figuratively elevated above the black masses below. At the same time, though, Pepper's balcony seat is furthest removed from Carter's orchestra on the opposite side of the concert hall. Both horizontally and vertically, the white alto saxophonist finds himself excluded from what Ralph Ellison would call a true jazz moment, the dynamic interaction between the musician and the dancers. But when Pepper attempts to bridge these gaps between himself and that moment, he finds that he simply does not belong. Ironically, it is the music of Benny Carter's orchestra, this music called jazz, that reverberates in the chasm between the whites-only balcony and the all-black dance floor. The spectacle of the discovery of Pepper's whiteness supplants, in his memory, the sound of the music that are emanating from the stage of fittingly a theatre. Art Pepper perceived a dramatic sea change in the jazz community that only intensified during the radical 60s. Instead of trying to help each other and enjoy each other, musicians have become petty and jealous. And the black power? A lot of the blacks want jazz to be their music and won't have anything to do with the whites. Jazz is an art form. How can an art form belong to one race of people? Lou Tobakin shares similar experiences and reinforces Pepper's statements. "When I was playing as a local up-and-coming player, I played in a lot of those black-orientated establishments. I was like the odd man out. Then, almost overnight, there was the beginning of a revolution. There had come a separation in the black clubs where I was trying to learn. At one point, it was really a very happy thing, but then at a certain point, it became a problem for a white guy to play in the black clubs." Serving 3 years in San Quentin, beginning 1961, Pepper found that the blacks were good to their people, but I started forming a dislike for them in jail because I thought, here I am, a guy that played jazz, had black friends, why wouldn't they talk to me, help me out? Because I'm white, I'm not a Mexican, the Mexicans helped me, not like the black sign, that raised fist that excluded me. Upon his first release from San Quentin in 1964, after serving 3 years for narcotics possession, Pepper formed a new all-white quartet, which he deliberately booked into black clubs. The following account from Straight Life about a gig at San Francisco's Jazz Workshop is representative of Pepper's whiteness within a black enclave. "It was an almost all-black club run by black people, and I went in there with an all-white band. They had all black bands all the time, but people were making these little remarks about whites and honkies. People would come in and say, "What do we got here? Where's the brothers and sisters at?" And they'd tell the guy that was running the place, "Say, blood, what is that up there? What is these guys trying to do? That's our music, black music, and we had to put up with all that shit." And they say, "White people can't play jazz," but I disapprove that, you know, because I played jazz, and all my white people played jazz. I had Bill Goodwin on drums, a great young drummer. I had Frank Strazzeri, an Italian, on piano. And I had a Jew, Hirsch Himmelstein. He changed his name to Hamel on bass. In a sense, then, this scene is the mirror image of Pepper's experience years earlier in the Durham Theatre, the sight of the sole white soldier engulfed by a sea of menacing violent blackness in Durham, and now his quartet on the elevated stage dramatises a spectacle of whiteness before a black audience. Crow Jim was not nearly as detrimental to Pepper's career, though, as white privilege was conductive. Pepper fitted well into the white jazz establishment's West Coast ideal, yet fellow alto saxophone player Sonny Criss, who was also based on the West Coast, found his strong gospel and blues tinge playing was less sought after and relocated to Europe. Those with the power, Criss later mused guardedly in a British fanzine, were pushing a certain type of record, a brand of music that most of the dedicated Negro musicians didn't want to play and weren't asked to play anyway. So in the same way as we saw earlier in James Baldwin's 1960 speech at Cambridge, integrating jazz has been a painfully slow process. Hatreds that are not natural in human beings are manufactured by racist laws that took place many years earlier in the very early days of jazz. So much so that even people normally without a racist bone in their bodies started believing that people are inferior or the enemy, and it can happen to blacks as well as whites. So how does this issue of race and segregation in American music amplify the myth that being black gives you a biological advantage, which it most certainly does not? To answer this question, we need to outline the birth of jazz music and the part race played in it.